Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming out. My name is John Slattery, and I've been an herbalist and forager working in around Tucson in the Sonoran Desert bioregion for the last 15 years. It's been what I've dedicated my life to, teaching people about plants, gathering plants for food medicine for myself, my family, friends, community. I started a herbal products company called Desert Tortoise Botanicals in 2005. And we've been serving Tucson and the greater southwest area since then. That's been stationed out of Tucson until just this past week. I got a partner to take production up to Utah, so I just recently retired from the farmers markets where I've been nearly weekly for the last 11 years, consulting with people and selling some of our products and learning a lot about how we can use our local plants for medicine. And then also recently I just released a book called Southwest Foraging, which I'll have copies at my booth once we go out there. So it's focused on plants throughout the Southwest that are edible and how to identify them with photos, full color photos, descriptions, seasons, time of year, what part to gather, how to do it, what you can do with it. And That's been my work for the last several years, but I'm also an herbalist. In terms of wild foods, one of my favorites are acorns. Anybody here not know that acorns are edible? Everyone here is familiar with acorns being edible by humans?
No, I'm not.
Okay. It's not an uncommon thing, so this is an unusual composition here to have a room full of people that everyone's aware that acorns are edible. And in nearly all cases where I've been, there's somebody there that either doubts it or firmly believes that no, they're not edible. Or in fact that the greatest bulk of food consumed by human beings throughout the history of time, granted this is not the easiest thing to pin down, but if you had a pile for each a representative pile for each food that we've consumed over time, acorns would be by far the largest pile on that table. Larger than wheat and rice combined, from what I've read from researchers. So wheat and corn, excuse me. So it's something that goes deep into our genetics, into our genome, in terms of how we've been nourished by this food in the past. And what I'd like to focus on today, not so much in terms of that greater cosmology throughout the Northern Hemisphere, in fact. All cultures, all settlements, to modern urban areas that we can look at today, from Los Angeles to Tokyo to London, even ancient settlements like Chichen Itza, to Jerusalem, Seoul, Korea, Tokyo, as I mentioned. All these places were surrounded by, either currently or in the recent past, by oak forests. And I would argue that was a big part of why they became great civilizations, is because they're proximity to oaks and all that the oaks offered us. Primarily, at least in first part, the acorns. So where are we at right now? We're not all over the Northern Hemisphere, but we're here in the Sonoran Desert bioregion. And what is the primary oak species in terms of food for people? That's Emory Oak, also known as bellota locally. So what I've taken to is, I've actually been doing most of my work in terms of food with the local landscape species in Tucson where I live. It's the southern live oak. Now that's not naturally occurring here. It occurs if you start going east, you'll start to see some disparate populations in southwest Texas. But really it begins in abundance in central Texas and goes all the way up to Maryland. In fact, it's a very widely spread species of oak, and it's grows to tremendous size and age. But we just, in the past 25, 30 years, have them in the Phoenix and Tucson area. And they're an abundant food source, totally untapped food source that I've been using for about a decade and now teaching people about it for the last few years on how to gather, process, and use them as food. It's actually quite simple, especially if you consider rural populations where if you're doing a portion of your grocery shopping in a distance of half an hour drive or more, maybe an hour round trip, you could prepare acorns for the week, acorn flour for the week, in about twice that time without ever leaving your home, gathering, you know, pulling from the acorn stash that maybe you gathered from your yard or adjacent area where you might frequently walk by. So I'll talk about that a little bit, but in terms of our specific area, back to the Emory Oak, this is the cherished oak species for its acorns in this region. Is anyone familiar with that or heard that before? A few people. In fact, there's an area that I'm not familiar with in terms of exploring it, but Tres Bellotas is a ranch nearby here, and that's an historic area where people, autumn, Mexican, so to speak, and Apache would all gather annually and come together in this place to gather acorns, so Bellotas specifically, because this was an area that was known for its abundance of acorns, the size of the acorns, and the sweetness of the acorns. So like all things, not all acorns are the same. And when you even speak about one individual species, not every single tree in that species is going to be the same either. You're going to get some that, you know, are particularly small and more bitter, some that are sweeter, fatter, literally have more fat and oils in them, and then some that are larger. And with the Emory Oak acorns, which I'm going to pass around shortly, and if you haven't tasted one, you're welcome, or even if you have, you're welcome to try one. You'll see that they're relatively small, especially if you may come from elsewhere in the country, particularly the Midwest and the East. In fact, bur oak naturally occurs as far as central Texas, actually further south than where we sit right now, but all east into Texas, and then up into the lower Midwest and into the eastern states. And bur oak is the largest acorn in North America. You can find bur oak acorns that are about that big. You can hardly hold three or four large ones in your hand at the same time because they're so big. Whereas with an Emory oak, you know, that's, you know, 10 of the largest Emory oaks acorns you're going to find are going to equal one of those. So there's a lot of time involved in the processing. So what am I referring to here, to backtrack a moment, Un Pueblo Magico de los Belloteros. That's a title I derived from discussions with my friends in Mexico, just over the border, and in a sense a world away, but within the same bioregion. So they're living with relatively the same plant and animal species, in the same weather, but an entirely socio-political world away. Literally just a stone's throw away in some cases. So the family that I'm referring to in particular is the Ruiz Cañas family. Doña Olga Ruiz is an herbalist, to put it simply. But more than that, she is an herbalist in exceptional sense, because she's been gathering herbs for 65 years, since she was 9 years old, traveling across Sonora by cart and burro, and living a semi-hunter-gatherer lifestyle. And she maintains that to some degree today in terms of her gathering wild foods and gathering herbs, even at the age of 75, going on 76. And exceptional not just in that, but that she's covered such a wide terrain in Sonora, from high elevation pine forest down to the sea. But the most of her life she's been in this border region, where the Emory Oak is abundant, in these rolling hill grassland savannas and canyonlands. Emory oak is most abundant. In fact, I've often said that Nogales should be called Bellotas, because there's way more oaks and acorns there than there are walnuts, which is what Nogales is referring to, the walnut tree. So in the past several years, we've been talking about this a lot. She showed me a lot of things about the acorn, but we hadn't really gone out until, because of the time, how it coordinates the harvest time with saguaro harvest. The Emory Oak acorns, unusually so, are ripening in the heat of the summer. Most people think of acorns in autumn. And with rare exceptions, if you go to look for Emory Oak acorns in the autumn, they'll all be gone. I can address that in a moment down the line. So, because of my interest in wild foods close to home, and the saguaro being the queen of them, I was always focused on gathering saguaro fruit at that time and missing the narrow window to gather with them. So this year, past year, we went out, and the stories that they told me about what it was like for them, particularly her sons, the eldest, or not the eldest, but the one that I know the best, he's around 52, 54, I think, and he talked about going out there and traveling to the oak grove at the age of around, I think he said 7 or 8 was the first time they went out there, and then they did it annually for years and years. And they would go out before they had vehicles, you know, have a cart and a couple of burros, and take everything that the family needed for about 6 to 8 weeks, and they would camp out there. And what would emerge would be a village, basically, in this oak forest, all centered around the acorn harvest. So my style is pretty non-linear, so this sort of presentation doesn't always coincide with what I'm talking about, but I'll get around to everything eventually or come back to it. Just for the sake of following this, acorn is the fruit of the unenclosed land. What I've been just describing is that this is an orchard of scents in the wild terrain. This is not something that's been sculpted by human beings necessarily. Although elsewhere in the world, particularly in Spain, they have managed their oak forests by burns and cuttings and plantings and so forth, which is quite different from my understanding of what's been done here. But nonetheless, this is a phrase that comes, I think, trace it back to the British Isles and possibly France as well. In fact, both places, acre, for instance, where does the term acre come from? Acreage. It's very likely a derivative of acorn, or acorn and acre are derivatives from earlier versions of those words. So it was how we determine the size of a land. Because, again, here I go, jumping around a little bit, but we, long, long ago, we were centered in, as hunting-gathering peoples, especially around the Mediterranean, centered around oak groves and consuming acorns. So we could tell relatively after a period of time how many people an acorn grove or an oak grove could sustain, say, over a decade, because the harvest of the annual production of acorns varies. They have what are called mast years, where they send out a bunch, and then maybe a couple, 2, 3, maybe 4 years where there's very little to none. In time, we started to take to animal husbandry, and they were raising pigs. They had domesticated pigs first in that region, and then started realizing that the wild pigs fed really well on the acorns, and they fattened up, and the meat was delicious. As is known today, where internationally the jamón ibérico from Spain, the pork that is raised on acorns, is world famous. So take that down several centuries later, maybe even millennia, we're starting to determine the size of land by how many pigs it could feed, based on the fact that it's probably acorns and maybe beech nuts, which are in the same family as oaks, that are feeding the animals. So this is the fruit of the unenclosed land for humans, and then eventually for animals as well, as we switch from consuming acorns ourselves and fattening our domesticated animals or livestock on the acorns. I should be more specific. It would just be pigs. Cattle are not going to get fat on acorns. Cattle and horses would it becomes toxic within a short period of time. Whereas pigs have something in their digestive tract that even we don't that can bind. It's called mucin. It's an enzyme that'll bind to the tannins in acorns, so it doesn't act as an anti-nutrient in their gut as it does for us. I'll get back to that too in a little while. The sacred oak was the tree which first produced food for mortal man. So this is just harkening back to some of the comments that I've made already. Pliny the Elder was an oft-quoted Greek scholar from, I want to say, around the 6th century BC, if there's any history buffs that can challenge me on that. But a long time ago, he said this. It was knowledge that had been passed down through the Greeks, however long Greek society was present. We really don't know, despite what is in the history books. It could be much, much longer than that. And the Arcadians were people that were often referred to in ancient Greece as the people that lived in the forests off of acorns. And they were known for their size, their strength, and their intelligence. So it was not, even though today you read something like, you check out acorn on Wikipedia, you'll say, yeah, the Greeks, it was a food of the poor for the Greeks, or a starvation food, and the Native Americans ate it. Something like that. Just pretty much discounting that all of the Northern Hemisphere was essentially raised on acorns. And not only that, thousands of years ago, people were remarking, well, you know, maybe it's not a lifestyle we want to go back to, but those people are really smart and they're strong. As is today, the bellote would be something that would be associated with who's food? Apache in this region. And as I mentioned, the Apaches would come down here. And I still know Apaches to this day that are gathering Emory Oak acorns as food. So this is an area that I went with my friends, a place that some of the Belloteros, or people who harvest Emory Oak acorns, have been going their whole life. This is just, what would it be, kind of, if you're familiar with Cananea, which is southwest of Bisbee, this is a little bit further southwest from there. Just in fact, I think just over that mountain is Cananea. So Quercus emorii is a scientific name. All oak species are Quercus. There's some other, as a different genera, that's called Lithocarpus, and those are called tan oaks, which in fact we have some in California, and those were some of the favored acorns of the indigenous people in California. In fact, one note on that, upon the time of contact with Europeans or the Spanish in the 16th century, arguably, that was the last extant Bolano culture that they came in contact with, or people that had an acorn-centered culture. 50% or more of the diet of some, or if not a majority, of the disparate tribes in California were centered around acorn consumption. And a quick figure for you. Within 2 to 3 weeks' time, a village could gather enough acorns to supply them with food for the next 3 years. So when I first heard that, I thought, wow, that's really a life of leisure. Yes, there's processing that happens from that point on, which is usually the work of the small children and the elders. And everyone in between that can be more active to plan out festivities, ceremonies, rituals, healings, hunt for meat, make baskets, so on and so forth, tell stories. It creates for a rich, embedded network of culture as afforded by diet centered on acorns. So again, back to Quercus emorii. These are all the states, Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona, where it's found. And then the bright green areas are the counties where you can actually find it. But in fact, this is quite marginal here in Texas. And I would say the bulk of it's right in here. So, and it goes further south. Of course, they ignore Mexico, but it's in Sonora and Chihuahua as well. So I would say where we're at right now is somewhat on the central western edge of its domain. If we go further west, we can find it in the Quinlan Mountains or above Kiveri Mountains, and I think after that, it's no longer found going west. So here's some qualifying facts, you might say, about Quercus emorii. If you've ever looked at oak trees and wondered what makes an oak different from another and how you identify them, in fact, oaks are very promiscuous. They cross-pollinate readily, with one major exception, and that's what makes Quercus emorii quite distinct, is because it is a red, or as a lot of people say, black oak. Has anyone ever heard that before? Black oak, white oak? If you read in books, in fact, if you read about processing acorns, eating them from food, a lot of sources will make very clear distinctions about one and the other. And you know, that might be true where they're at and what they're looking at, what they're working with, but those are not absolutes and those are not global truths. In fact, they can be totally misleading. Because in fact, many sources will say black oaks are very high in tannins. So the Emory Oak entirely contradicts that. It's one of the lowest tannin acorns that are known, roughly 1%, versus some that could be 10 to 28% tannins. So I'll get to that again later. So I say red more strictly because it comes from the erythral part of that, erythrobalanus, which is a subgenus. Erythro meaning red in Greek. Erythrocytes, anyone ever heard of those? Those are our red blood cells. And then, so all oak species, and so again, Quercus emorii is a black oak. There's only one other black oak in our entire range, and that's the silverleaf oak, which you wouldn't even find around here. But say you go to Mount Lemmon, or the Santa Rita's, or Rincon Mountains, there's a little bit of an area where they overlap, but they're two totally distinct species by sight. So it's very easy to distinguish an Emory Oak when you apply these qualities. This is something that pertains to all oak trees, separate male and female flowers. It's a botanical term that's referred to as dioecious. Sorry, monoecious. I just get that confused, dyslexic. So it means that you have all the flowers are in one house or on one tree, but you have separate male and female, so they're not perfect. Like a sunflower or a rose, they'll have all the male and female parts in one flower. We'll see that in some photos coming up. We'll make it really evident. And then this is something that we're also going to look at, the white, fuzzy inner shell of the acorn. That pertains to red and black oaks. And that corresponds to this next line. The testa adheres to the nut. It's like a peanut. You ever get peanuts out of the shell and there's the flaky, thin covering? That's a testa. And on the black oak acorns, or red oak more specifically, that adheres very tightly to the nut. Hard to get off. And that's part of the bitterness of the acorns as well. Low tannin content of acorns, that's specific to emery oak. And then pointed leaves with sharp points along the margin, mostly, as I say. That is a quality of red oaks or black oaks in general, but it is also probably 80% of the time or more present with what you're looking at on an emery oak tree. Although, as I say, oaks can vary quite a bit. Anyone have any questions on that?
The flowers on the male and female, are they on separate trees? Male flowers on one tree, female on the other?
No, they're on a single tree. That's what makes it monoecious. I misspoke when I said dioecious, which means two houses, which means you'd have a tree with just male and a tree with just female, like a juniper. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you'll look for juniper berries and it'll only be on some trees. And others, none whatsoever, ever, because it's only a male tree. Okay, so this is a good time to pass around. I've got two different populations of emery oak acorns here. I'm going to pass one around on both sides. They're both marked where they came from, and then you'll notice if you don't see them side by side, maybe take one and then hold it and grab the other one, you can see they're quite different in appearance as well. This side, it's marked, but yeah, feel free to take one and try it. This one is from the area that I first showed you the photograph of the oak tree in Sonora. And then this side is from Oak Flat. Oak Flat is a Forest Service campground that has been a sacred area to the Apache for a long, long time. It's just north of Superior, Arizona. And a place that has been in the midst of a conflict for a number of years, actually, due to mining interests in the area. I don't know if anyone's familiar with that, but they're starting to kick that up again in terms of the opposition to that, which would essentially destroy the oak grove and everything else, all the other life there, including the water supply. So what you can look at, if you get to opening those, the inner shell you're going to see is very fuzzy, and you can certainly feel it. And then on the nut, which you're not seeing the outside of the nut, but when you get your nut out, it should have the testa adherent. Occasionally it'll slough off easily, but it's probably still going to be fuzzy on the nut, on the outside of it. And then you see here on the inside of it, it's quite yellow. Maybe that's more yellow than any of you would have expected to see from an acorn if you hadn't seen an acorn before. Do you have a question, sir?
It was about the mine at Oak Flat.
Oh, okay, a comment or a question?
I'm just wondering what the status was.
Yeah, it's a good question. I can't speak too clearly right now. I'm not that up to date. What this yellow color is indicating is that it's high in vitamin A and vitamin E as well. So one of the both fat-soluble vitamins. And there's plenty of fat, omega-6 fatty acids, in emery oak acorns. One of the traditional Apache methods of preparing these bellotas is to grind them up, shell them, grind them up, and then put that flour directly into a stew after it's finished cooking. Essentially, to remove it from the heat, put the acorn flour in there and put the lid on and let it sit for a while. And basically, it infuses the stew with the vitamins as well, and then the stew becomes yellow as a consequence. And by not cooking it, they're going to preserve the relatively volatile fat-soluble vitamins that are that can degrade upon exposure to heat, excessive heat over time.
Are all acorns edible?
Oh yeah, yeah. Sorry if I didn't make that clear off the from the start.
I was raised in Ohio and we had very large oak trees with good-sized brown acorns. And I think I remember as a child tasting them and they were so much bitter.
I'll get to that.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I've been alluding to it so far. Let me see this next slide real quick. Go back, please. I wasn't sure what was next. So, the way, as I just described, one of the Apache methods of consuming these is shelling them, as you've all just done, I think, with your teeth, which is quite relatively easy. The shells are not that hard on the Emory Oak acorns. And then separating the nut meats, and then grinding all the nut meats separately into a flour. In fact, when I met some of the Apache there at the camp, they were very proud. Once I started to talk about and ask them about these things with the acorns, they were very proud to show me their bag of acorn flour that they have, which is amazing. You know, you're just doing one or two maybe right now, but to do even just that, what's left in that jar probably take any of us at least a half an hour. You know, it's not a very easy job shelling these. But currently in Sonora, you can buy these just in a bag on the side of the road. Beginning of July, drive over the border in Nogales and there'll be a lot of people with plastic bags wanting to sell you bellotas. Because they're a common snack food. People are still, they wouldn't be out there selling them if people weren't buying them. So it's popular. People still eat it. Even when they can go and buy a bag of Doritos for maybe a fifth of the price, just as easily, people are still buying acorns, which is great. I'm excited about that for many different reasons. One, because the culture remains alive, and two, it's such an exceptionally healthier food for people as well. But people are simply eating them as snack food. There are preparations, in fact, I've made one today to share with you guys in a little bit, but predominantly people are just eating these acorns out of hand. So there's two facts about Emory Oak acorns that most people, acorn enthusiasts around the country, without that knowledge, would balk at believing those statements. One, that it's a black oak and has low tannins, and that two, that people customarily eat these right out of the shell without any processing whatsoever. That's really unusual in the world of acorns, not just in this region, but North America and the earth as a whole. So this is an exceptional acorn to have here for, you know, two of the primary reasons. Yeah. I'll go back to that subject in a little bit, while also reconnecting with what I earlier said about southern live oak acorns, which I've been using for food for many years. It's a different process. They're a different acorn, quite a bit different. Than the Emory Oak. Okay, so to touch back onto some of those lists of details that I was mentioning, here we have on the left side, those are the male catkins, or the staminate flowers, the male flowers on this side. Maybe some of you have noticed that driving around in this area, that in the springtime, maybe as early as late March into April, these will appear. Sometimes into May as well. And then they'll be littered underneath the tree, maybe on vehicles and on the ground. These dehiss or fall off the tree quite readily. Whereas over here, we have, yeah, this is a growing acorn. And then next to it is a female flower or a pistil flower that has not been fertilized. I'm saying that because I'm presuming they came out at about the same time. And this one was fertilized and grew, and this one hasn't. We can see, anyone familiar with botanical terminology, even still at this nearly mature acorn here and up here, I don't know how clear it is, but it's like two antenna. Those are the stigma of the flower. Those are that's the catcher's mitt, so to speak, for the pollen. When the pollen gets blown by the wind or perhaps carried by an insect, it touches here. That's the next step for that to get in. It brought down the style into the ovary to fertilize the acorn. So all that has to happen for this to happen, for this to start to grow. So the first step in observing these populations is to go out in the spring and see what's happening on the trees as early as late March. And certainly there's maybe even some of you know some sayings from this region as they occur in all places in the globe. You know, a certain type of weather at this month begets a certain type of flowering and fruiting of oaks later on, or an abundance of fruiting of oaks indicates a really snowy and wet, cold winter. Various things like that that have, you know, people have been observing and telling these stories for eons. In fact, does anyone have any of those for this region? I'd be curious to know. Yeah, so this is just a cluster of ripening, relatively large Emory Oak acorns. And you can see here quite clearly the points on the leaf. It's not entirely universal. In fact, I don't know if it's the angle of the photo, it might be, but this leaf looks really smooth. But it's not unusual. Oaks have quite a variation in leaf structure. But you will normally find the Emory Oaks from 1 to 2 in a particular cluster, but then clusters might be right next to each other. They don't grow in they're not like grapes. They don't grow in a long cluster like that. There'll be a couple of them. So it can take some time if you were to look for just ripe acorns off the tree. What we really do is pick them off the ground. Where would you find them? Mixed oak woodland. Quercus oblongifolia is around here up on the hillsides. Usually when you're down below and you look up around here, you'll see a white-trunked oak. That's the Mexican blue oak. Has a bluish-green tinge to the leaves. Those are far more frost-sensitive, so back around 2011 and 13, that looked like some of them had died off with the drought and then the freeze. But it seems like most of them actually have stabilized.
What are their acorns like?
They're not as abundant, and they're not as sweet as the Emory Oak. And then Quercus arizonica, this one you can find down in the canyons as well. I know Peña Blanca Canyon, Sycamore Canyon, I can find large Arizona white oaks. Those have decent acorns. Again, they're not as abundant. They can be even a little bit smaller than the Emory Oak, and more tannic, so not as sweet, is another way to say that. Oak juniper woodlands, juniper pinon, Arizona pine, pine dug fir. So these are a variety of habitats which you can find the Emory Oak, but predominantly, this is what you're going to see around here, mixed in with these two species. And then also adjacent to savanna, grassland. So back to the Belloteros. These are the guys that I went gathering with last June. So I was referring to him earlier, Oscar. He's Doña Olga's son, the one that accompanies her most on her forays. I think actually Chivirico is his older brother. So they had stories of going to the Emory Oak harvesting camp from the young age. This gentleman too, he had been with them since they were children. They're all also known as pajareros. Has anyone ever heard that term before? So they're a subgroup, a cultural subgroup in Sonora. These were equated somewhat with gypsies. And as I said, they live somewhat of a hunter-gatherer lifestyle. Their mother, her heritage is Otom and presumably Seri. But she did not grow up culturally with them, but just very little influence from the Otom. And then at a young age, she and her father, who was Otom, and her other sister, embarked on these escapades with these pajarero people that traveled by foot and by cart and burro all over Sonora to work as itinerant farm laborers, to just basically camp and do hunter-gatherer camps where the men would go out and hunt deer, and the women would be preparing food and gathering medicine and wild foods and maybe hunting lizards or desert tortoises around camp. And they would live that way as long as they could, and then go back to, you know, harvest season, go back and work in the fields or glean after a harvest. They still do that to this day. When I go visit them near Christmas time, I'll have a bag of peanuts that she'll have freshly roasted because they had just gone to the Valle de Sonora and behind the peanut harvest and pick up a costal, a huge bag of peanuts that didn't get picked up in the mechanized process. So this has been an aspect of their lifestyle, gleaning from the wild and gleaning from cultivated lands. And so these guys were so excited as youngsters to go to this camp of the Belloteros, the people that would harvest Emory Oak acorns. And as Oscar was telling me, he said, I could see his face light up as he was describing it, that it was like a time from, a magical time from long ago. He said, we'd set up, everyone would pick their own tree, either a large mesquite tree or an Emory Oak tree, and that would be your camp. That would be your home. And you'd have your fire there at night. And he said, every night you'd see that boom, 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 all these other fires would start accumulating till it was like a large village of people. And it got to the point where people were, one person had a reel-to-reel projector, and then he would set up canvases around a tree and sell tickets. People would come in and watch the latest Mexican movies on his reel-to-reel projector. And there were famous musicians, mariachi singers and musicians performing every night. So it was a gathering of peoples from a bioregion, sharing information, sharing experience, sharing stories, sharing their talents in a variety of ways. And then people from Hermosillo would come up with their vehicles, and they would be buying the acorns, either to consume or to resell in the city. And so as a young boy, he said they could get a quart of acorns, turn it in, and then either receive melons, which people from Hermosillo would bring up, so they basically had currency now that they could buy what they wanted, or on occasion get some coins for it as well. And then they would gather enough acorns for themselves that they would eat and snack on for the rest of the year. And so when he talked about this, he was reflecting. I could see his, you know, his gaze going into the distance. He said, Juanito, era un pueblo mágico. And that's where I got the title for this. He said it was a like a magical village. You know, people that weren't there, they were there under the auspices of the acorns. Nobody owned the land there. There was no title to the land by anyone present. He said there were ranchers that owned the land, but they didn't care. It was fine that these people came and did this. It was all, it was open game, so to speak. And so these guys had been maintaining these traditions for, you know, close to 50 years. In fact, I bought all the acorns. It was a really bad year, so I bought all the acorns that this guy, and I think the guy in the green shirt in the back, that they had gathered this past year, because, you know, if I didn't buy them, they were going to sell them probably to somebody else who sells them on the roadside that was going to give them like half the price. So I wanted to, you know, they were depending to some extent on what they could earn from the harvest this year. And I thought there was another point I was going to make there. But basically what this brought to my attention was that there was a culture around this. It wasn't just a wild food that people liked, but it was something that brought people together. That oaks and acorns had that power unlike anything else that I'm aware of. And it's not just here. I started to learn about this from elsewhere, you know, from Spain, the Mediterranean, North Africa, Korea, even India. In fact, India, where we get the word druid from, I know this is a huge shift and twist, but where we get the word druid from stems from the ancient Sanskrit word for tree, which was the same word for oak as it was for tree, duer. And so the druids became the observers of the oak tree. And so there's I think the reason I bring that up is it paints a broader picture of the metaphysical and even abstract relationship that we as a people have with the oak trees, whether we realize it or not. I know I've felt this before I learned any of these things. You know, being in the Chiricahuas, say, in the summertime, camping in an oak grove, it's like there's no better place to be. It's cool, the air is clean and it's warm, but it's cool at the same time, there's water flowing nearby, nothing better than living in the shade of an oak forest. And so I'm honored to have met some of these guys and to hear their stories, and I intend to continue this work and learn even more about not only what they experience and what transpired in these camps of the Belloteros, but also what has happened elsewhere, you know, amongst the Apache, amongst the Autumn. I think at this point there's very few people alive that have experienced this. You know, there's, you know, people in a wheelchair somewhere that remember going as a child with their grandparents. So those are the kinds of stories I've heard. So here we are gathering the acorns. Everyone's got their gathering vessel, you know, whatever recycled plastic container they could muster, and I'm just picking them up one by one off the ground. This is quite a large oak tree that we're under. In fact, it was one of only, say, two or three oak trees that we gathered from. It was not a good year. Most of the trees had none, and then there were several more trees that had super tiny acorns that you could argue weren't worth the time to gather. And so there were many that were, we were there at the end of June. There were ripening, nearly ripe acorns on the tree. So my friend Oscar was attempting with a large stick at the end of the rope to throw it up there and grab the branch and shake it and knock some off, which we did a lot of. Speaking with the passing people, they would not do this under any circumstances. They would never beat the tree. They would only catch what was falling underneath the tree, either by picking it up by hand, what we just saw, or setting out tarps or sheets or something, or maybe long ago skins under the tree and picking up what would fall on there. Because as a basically in relation to the respect that they felt for the tree, and they didn't feel it was respectful to hit the tree or to shake it to loose the acorns.
In that vein, would it the acorn continue to ripen if it was knocked down before?
It's really hard to get an acorn off that's not ripe. I will gather some from a tree when I'm in a place that there isn't any on the ground, and I can see that there are some in reach that are near. I just basically just barely touch it. If it falls in my hand, it's ready. But yeah, for some reason, it'll still hold on just a little bit, but it basically takes just the tiniest bit of pressure and it'll come off. If I have to apply a little bit more pressure and it's not coming, I let it go. So I assume that, you know, with the exception of actually hitting the acorn that might knock it loose, I don't know, as small as those things are, they're actually quite sturdy and quite resilient to holding it on, because it's, you know, it's the job of the trees to keep those in the roost until they're ready to go out. Anyhow, so this is, in fact, some of the things that acorns that I passed around today were from this harvest. He didn't have a container, so I used his hat. And then these are the acorns that I gathered up in Oak Flat. Happened to be the first week of August, so things were falling a little bit later up there, but you notice how much different the color is. I don't know if you guys noticed that when I passed them around due to the lighting, but they were much lighter in the location in Sonora, and then quite a deep red here in Oak Flat. It's the darkest I've seen. Yes, sir?
In our region, when the acorns are falling, at night the deer come, so you have to be very timely. Is that the case here in this area?
Well,
They seem to know.
It's a good time to bring that up. So there's a timeliness to it, and here it's more about the rains. Because these are relatively low in tannins, they can sprout more quickly, for one. But also what happens in the summer, when summer rains come, a lot of grass and plants start to come up behind them really quickly, which makes it difficult to see and find the acorns. To have to search through the grass takes exponentially longer. So you have to get out there, they have to fall, and then if the rains come right away, that's okay, but within a couple days, 2, 3, 4 days maybe. But you also see that we're in a wash. If it's a big rain, it could take all the acorns away too. So timeliness can be exceptionally essential in some years. And then the other thing you say, I haven't seen much evidence of that with the emery oaks. I've been in central Texas, camped out there when the acorns are falling, and it's a sound of crunch, crunch, crunch all night long. The deer will basically just bed down in an area where they can, you know, extending their neck, eat for an hour or so, just by eating what's right in front of them. One other thing I want to say about that, in terms of the acorns getting wet, acorn weevils. I don't have any pictures of those here, but acorn weevils have a proboscis. That's like a long, thin spike that comes off their nose, essentially. And occasionally you'll see ones with a little hole in them. Maybe some have even found one in the jar. So that hole is actually the exit hole for the weevil larva to then crawl back into the ground and be born next year with the rain. So the proboscis penetrates the acorn when it's on the tree in those green stages that I saw, or possibly on the ground when the rain hits the fallen acorns. And so the longer you wait into the season, the more insect predation you might have in your acorns. So that's another, probably the biggest issue for wild harvesting acorns, is to gather them up quickly before the insect larvae start to consume them. One thing that I've done with these, as soon as I gather, I put them in the freezer for about 24 hours. In case there are any eggs in there, that it's not going to hatch, presumably, and start to consume the whole acorn. Basically, you have a shell full of frass or insect poop. Question, comment?
I was going to say I got lucky one year and went out of up after the rains, and in the washes I found places where they drifted, and I could pick them up by the hand.
Yeah, that is for
sure. Through them to pick out the ones that were almost.
And in some cases, the insect predated acorns will float to the top in water. So that could be a way to separate them. Doesn't always work, my experience with the emery oak, but other ones it can work quite well. Okay, yeah, go ahead. Next one. There's something I came upon in Peña Blanca. Somebody's discarded jeans. That was another method for collecting acorns. Anyway. I'll just go through this quickly, but wanted to point out there's other things you can find in the Belotal or in the Emory Oak Forest, other delicious and healthy nutritive foods. This is the oyster mushroom, and this is growing right off of an Emory Oak. I brought some bark around. I'll just do that while I'm...
Is that a live tree or a dead tree?
That's a dead tree, yeah, fallen tree. I'll just pass around some Emory Oak bark. It comes off in sheets quite nicely. So yeah, this is a perfectly safe, I'm not going to go into mushroom ID, but this is a delicious and often abundant mushroom. And then here's the, and all these plants are featured in my book, the Southwest Foraging book that I'll have out at my booth after this. The most abundant summer green all throughout the Sonoran Desert bioregion, you can gather this in mass and either dry it or blanch and freeze it to have it throughout the year. So that's one way to take advantage of an abundant harvest, because these can come up in the millions in the royals and expansive washes. Bledo, as it's known locally, pigweed or amaranth, the green is definitely the most abundant and nutritive part of the plant. Yes, the seed could be harvested, but I would forego the seed in favor of this whenever I had the chance. Excellent edible, raw or cooked. When raw, is really high in vitamin K, which is an essential vitamin that we need alongside vitamin D to make the most use of vitamin D, just as a side note. And otherwise, very high, very nutrient-dense food. Another one that I found growing underneath the emery oaks, this is the alpine wood sorrel. Wood sorrel, common scientific name, genus is oxalis. That's where we get the name oxalic acid. So maybe some of you are concerned with oxalic acid if you'd had calcium kidney stones. Yes, that's a rare concern, but for the most part, this is a safe food for everyone. What most people don't know, aside from the lemony sweet taste of the leaves, stems, and flowers, these have semi-translucent tubers that are almost like a water chestnut in texture, have a quite mild flavor, but they're juicy. When you find these in abundance, you can dig them up. They're quite small, you know, about the size of a quarter in surface area, but about half of an inch deep. Okay, so this is where I wanted to get to finish off. These are a number of, as I described these dishes here, some of the traditional methods of preparation of emery oak acorn, aside from just eating them out of the shell. I made what Doña Olga is making here on her, this is her home stove, this is where she does all of her cooking. You can see this is a coil from the backside of a refrigerator, and this is, they have a refrigerator underneath that they fill with soil and cement and painted bricks on the outside of it, and then put bricks on top of that, and this is her outdoor kitchen where she does all her cooking 365 days a year. So I did my best to try to make enough for everyone, but yesterday I toasted some emery oak acorns and made coffee, café de bellota as it's called. So it's not caffeine containing coffee, it's just roasted acorns. It's plain. In fact, maybe there's somebody that could help me with this so I could talk while it's being poured and passed out.
We are getting toward the next speaker, so maybe we could do this, I don't know, in the back or outside, if that would be possible.
Okay, all right, so I'll just figure that out, I guess, once we finish. I have running out of time, but anyone who wants to have some Emory Oak acorn coffee, I'll provide it for you, I guess, in the kitchen space out here or wherever they see fit. So anyhow, the first one, pipitoria, is something like peanut brittle. I've made that also. Maybe some people have had this traveling Sonora. It's pecans that are encrusted in sugar. Same thing with acorns. Galletas or bizcochuelos, those are cookies that are made with Emory Oak acorn flour, and none of these are leached. If you want to talk about acorn leaching, you can see it in my book, and I can talk to you about it at my booth, but I won't have time to get into that today. Enchiladas de bellota, there's another classic harvesting area in, I want to call it Cedar Wash, something like that, that's on the north side of Mount Graham in between the Santa Teresa Mountains and Pinaleños. And a family there, he said that his grandmother used to make enchiladas de bellota, or sopes, which is, sopes are corn, fried corn. They're not like a tortilla, they're thicker, almost like polenta cake from Italy. And they would also do that with a thick acorn cake and then top it with beans or chicken or carnitas or something like that. Those are all traditional preparations. And so I just posed this question, what does the future look like for bellotas, you know, bellotas? One thing I didn't get to talk about much is the ecological status of the Emory Oak tree. There's a lot of areas where it's substantial die-off. And so we've had a lot of climatic change here in the past couple decades. Velvet mesquite is taking over in a lot of areas where Emory Oaks have been. So is that what we're looking at as the future, or is there a possible chance that Emory Oaks might move up the mountains wherever that's possible? That remains to be seen. But we're definitely at a transition point where this knowledge is getting older and older within the culture and dying out, and practice less and less. So certainly one thing that I'm committed to is spending more time with these trees and the people that have, trying to create more opportunities for other people to do that, educate people about it, encourage them to go out into their local areas and to explore these trees, gather acorns, experiment, and share what you learn. And so I guess that's it for today. Thank you for joining me. If you guys want any information about my classes, you can visit my website. I also have cards up here. And like I said, I will be out at my booth as soon as I get that set up. And if anyone would like to try the acorn coffee, I'd love to share some with you. If you need me to move out, I will do it on the other side of this door here in the kitchen area.